Hi guys, welcome to the Retro Avant Garde Film Festival. My name is Evgeniya Orudzheva. So we're continuing with our film industry conversations where we bring industry people, producers, film directors, and also casting agents, talent agents to give you advice and tools how to expand your careers. So today our guest is Stanislav Yershov. He is a film producer and also the owner and the creative director of an amazing cinema located in St. Petersburg, Russia, Aglitter Cinema. Stanislav has worked as a jury in Berlinale, and he will be our honor guest jury in the upcoming Retro Avant-Garde Film Festival, Venice 2021 edition, will happen next year. Hello, Stanislav. Thank you for coming.
Good evening, good morning. I don't know when all the participants will be listening and watching this video. Hi.
I know. All around the world. Hi. Thank you so much for coming and sharing your experience, advices. So I have a couple questions for you. Maybe you can start telling us about how you became a film producer and a little bit about your cinema.
It's a very long story, but I try to be quite short. In 2000, I becoming the CEO of Gorky Film Studio. In Moscow, it's the second largest film studio in Russia. And honestly speaking, it's happened not because I'm so experienced filmmaker, but the studio have a lot of problems in the 90s, and it will be practically bankrupt. So it will be bankruptcy situation, and somebody have to be to save the company, and I come in like a crisis manager for this. But honestly speaking, cinema and filmmaking is so attractive and so emotional and so unusual lifestyle. And if you are coming one day, you already be, you know, it's like a disease, but disease, you know, very pleasant disease. You're becoming, you cannot already just take some drugs or some, I don't know, medicine and avoid and become healthy. You're already ill.
Agree
for all the your life, and I was a CEO for 10 years, and we are making quite a lot of scenes and positive scenes, and studio still exists, still producing. Definitely it was the first time when I touched the world of the cinema so close, when you have to make not simple clothes, not to come to just say hello, but the time when you have to make decisions. And I'm going to tell you that it was very exciting trip, and I like it very much. And I cannot say we have achieved all the things which we have planned, but still we have, during these 10 years, we have two films in Venice Film Festival in the main competition. We have the film in Berlinale in the panorama section, in many other festivals all around the world, Busan, Toronto, etc., etc. We're producing a few TV series. We're producing some quite remarkable, some interesting Russian blockbuster, for example, like a Generation P, based on the novel Viktor Pelevin, and many others. And in 2010, unfortunately, I live in the studio. Someday, already staying and living in St. Petersburg, I discovered a very unique place. It was auditorium hall in Anglitter Hotel, which is a historical hotel in St. Petersburg. It's already more than 200 years history. So practically St. Petersburg is around, let me say, 300 years history. So the hotel's 200 history, years history. So that you understand, it's quite old hotel. And we are decided to open the cinema. Honestly speaking, because I have two fever in my life, three, honestly. One is the cinema, the second is the classical opera theater, classical musical theater, like opera and ballet theater, and I working for a long time with the Mariinsky Theater, with Maestro Gergiev, etc., etc. And we, honestly speaking, we are decided to open the place where people can come and to see the classical opera translation, live transmission from the Metropolitan, for example, and from all our the top opera companies from around the world, like Scala, like Staatsoper in Vienna, etc., etc. But as soon as we start to do it, immediately understand that we have some more space in our schedule to put some films as well. And it was a good reason to open in 2013. the place which called Kino&Taetr, because of, you know, the hotel is very famous and very well known all around the world. For example, because of the in Silver Ages and beginning of the 20th century, it was the place where the Isidora Duncan lived with the Sergei Yesenin, and where the Sergei Yesenin died, for example. So it's very well-known historical place, and many famous people around the world for all the centuries and all the periods of Russian history will stay in this hotel. And it was not so easy decision, but, you know, it was decision quite obvious. And but when we start decided about the name of the cinema, some, you know, crazy marketing people come in and say, let's call it Yesenin, for example, or some other way, but it's... doesn't matter how you name, how what will be the name of the cinema, because in ordinary life, if the people decided to go to the cinema in Anglitere, they will tell each other, let's go to Anglitere to watch this film.
That's true, yeah.
That's, no doubts about this. And there is, it's the reason why the place called cinema, so Kino&Taetr in Russian, mm-hmm. it's the name of the title of the cinema, but we have some English version for foreigner people, for expats, it's called Anglitere Cinema Lounge or Cinema in Anglitere.
Well, and hopefully when I'm in Russia next time, I will be able to visit it as well. How do you choose that you're going to show there?
You know, it's a very special selection. We not screen these crazy blockbusters, both Russian and Hollywood or some other countries. Not because it's worse or it's bad, but it's just in other films. It's not for our auditory, because we, during this... already more than 7 years, we are trying to attract and we are collect people who are really like very serious, very interesting, like festival, art house films, etc., etc. One of the features of our project that it's impossible to see the Dublin films in our space, so only original language with Russian subtitles. So if film released in Tarain, or in Japanese, or in French, or in Italian, or in English, doesn't matter. The original language is very principal point, but always followed by, supported by the Russian subtitles on the bottom of the screen, definitely. So it's very festival screening. And we have plenty of the events, different kind of the festivals, which already traditionally happen in our cinema, like one of the, like number one documentary film festival, Ardoc Fest. For example, like West Wind at Festival of European Oscar, like special all the national cinema weeks like Amfest, Britfest, Czech or Norwegian or Swedish or Jewish Film Festival just we hosted in October this year, for example. The first film festival was happening in our place. So it was, like I tell, the place for the people who are considers the cinema not only like a attraction, not like something to relax, but come to think, maybe to understand something, maybe to recognize something, maybe to follow some new culture, some new tradition, etc., etc. So it was quite special audience, and we try to keep it, and we already for 5 or even more, I think, years in the list of the 50 best cinemas all around Europe. Oh, and wow. we are members of the Eurimash and Europa Cinema Association. So we are, for example, just last weekend, we have, it was 8th of last Sunday, 8th of November, it was International European Art House Day. So all around the world, all the members of our association screening only art house European films, and it was very attractive. And this year is very special year, for example, as well. We have special program dedicated to 100 years of the birthday of the Federico Fellini. Oh, so the final screening on the final, the top screening on Sunday was the Dolce Vita by Federico Fellini, restored, amazing copy, completely restored, definitely in Italian with Russian subtitles, but in big screen. And I'm going to tell you, plenty of the people from the city, nevertheless, not see, not even we have a lot of restriction now because of the COVID situation, but still we have quite a lot of people coming to watch this already classical.
That's really nice. I also wanted to ask you about the Berlinale Film Festival and how was your experience as a jury there?
Let's, from very beginning, I'll be honest with you, it will be not the main jury of the Berlinale, because it's a star place for the filmmakers from stars, directors and actors from all around the world, but there are a few juries. One of them is a jury which based and founded by Europa Cinema Foundation, the second small jury, like it's called in Berlinale sometimes, because this jury judge only the European films.
Mm-hmm.
Not international, but European. But from all the programs, not only from main competition, but as well from the Panorama, for example, and from other sections. And it was absolutely amazing experience. What I recognize that is, I'm not so often taking part in the juries, but this was really amazing experience. And what I discovered, so please understand, it's really hard job, hard work. So just you have to forget about the parties, about the some to do what you like, because you have to watch plenty of the films. It was something like, if I'm not mistaken, around 20 films which I have to see, have to watch during the 10 days. So it's two films per day, and it's a big responsibility what I'm going to tell you. So just because of I'm as well try to do from time to time something myself, to produce something myself, so my own production, my own films. And you know, sometimes you read the synopsis and say, okay, listen, it's kind of a stupid film, why I have to go to watch it, never ever to do it in my regular. I visited Berlinale maybe already for, I don't know, 20 years, and what for, you know, it's enough, it's clear for me, so it's not interested, not in the sphere of my interest, not so attractive for me. But later on I decided, no, listen, people spend the time, they do this film and they wait for the judgment. It's very responsible, you have to come to watch it. It's very responsible and very serious, really tough work, you know, I'm going to tell you, every day you have to spend the time, etc. It's not even talking about the discussion inside of the jury and inside of the to make the decision, etc., etc. But it was quite pleasant since it was combined definitely with the dinner or with the lunch, so it was nice.
Для них, для всех, это серьезная конкуренция. Они все работают бесплатно, чтобы было понятно, да. То есть группы, как бы для них это способ конкурировать. Да, есть призовые, как бы деньги, есть призовой фонд, за который они бьются. Но это реальный батл, батл идей, батл соревнования каких-то решений, неординарных ходов.
So I wanted to ask you a couple questions, if you have advices or tools for filmmakers. We have a lot of great short films and feature films who won in New York Film Festival and other film festivals that we have. And how people should go about distributing their films other than film festival? How to get into the movie theaters or any advice you can give?
I think the first and the number one advice, start thinking about this before you start production. It's the first thing which you have to do in the very beginning. Before you start production, you have to think how to distribute it, not after. If you're speaking about the short film, it's quite difficult. You have to find the almanac, because it's impossible to screen the short film in the cinemas now.
Mm-hmm.
It's a difficult thing. So just to be part of some program or to be part of the some festival, etc., etc. I can tell you about one experience which we have developed, for example, in Tatarstan. It's a very interesting area and very developed area in Russia, the part of the Russia. It's a Russian Federation, but still it's located in the capital of the Kazan. It's a very nice city, very old city, with the Kremlin, but white Kremlin,
mm-hmm.
with the mosque and with the Orthodox Church inside, and with a lot of history and a lot of different culture, Tatar culture, etc., etc. And we developed the project, which we are based on the short film. Definitely, it's one of the main aims to produce 10 international, by international teams, 10 films, 10 short films. The title of the project is 7 Film Days, so the people, the filmmakers have only 7 days to produce. They have quite a lot of time for prepare, for develop the project, but for shooting, the only limit is the shooting must be happening in Kazakh. And we invited 10 people, 10 teams from all around the world. Last year, for example, it was China, Germany, Finland, France, Mongolia, Iran.
Mm-hmm.
What else? France. and three Russian team from Moscow, St. Petersburg, and Karachay, Cherkessia, and they have 7 days to produce the film and present it to the jury. It's a battle. It's good prize, fund, money.
And those would be short films. How should people go about feature films? I understand you speak about before, but if they did not?
Honestly speaking, serious production never start before. Because of the, it's already quite big money involved, and you have to think about it. You have quite a lot of possibilities for find some co-production. For example, any co-production market, they immediately ask you about the possibility of distribution all around the world or in your country, etc., etc. I think the best place, from my feeling, what I feel, what I know, the one of the best places is Berlinale market, one of the which take place parallel with the Berlinale Film Festival. It's one of the biggest co-production market, and I know that a lot of deals was reached in this. Mm-hmm. And definitely you have to apply here and in all other festivals as well. And the co-production is one of the, I think, the main answer for all these questions, because of the, it's venture investments to the cinema. It's very difficult to, if you produce something in one country, to distribute it in one country to return all the money which you are spent on this project. But if you distribute in many countries, if you get the project company partners from other countries, this will be for you a good reason to distribute it in other countries as well. And it's shares the risk, shares the possibilities, and attracts the new possibilities to distribute. So the co-production is the answer, I think, here. It's the reason why, for example, we start developing this project film for 7 days in Tatarstan and Kazan, just to attract and to explain people all around the world, this is a good location for shooting and for local people to explain how to do it, to attract the technology, to attract the cultural filmmaking, etc., etc. And out of this collaboration, I think some big projects can be growing up, you know. But the only thing is to do it step by step, you know, not to do it, not start immediately with a blockbuster for 40 million euro. Don't think about it. Yeah. Small, simple, and clear things.
Yeah, definitely. I also have a question for financing. How should people go about financing their movie?
I think if you are a producer, definitely there are plenty of institutes all around the world which propose some money. But it's the same story which I told now, mentioned about co-production. In Russia, we have Ministry of the Culture, which subsidizes it. But the main question which I'm going to ask any young producer who is going to invest some money in the cinema, the question may be like this. I already do not buy a new car and spend this money for the film, or sell your apartment and buy the smaller one and the difference used to finance. You have to be responsible for what you're doing. If you're ready to do this, it doesn't mean that you have to start with this, but you have to be ready that this situation will come later on when you will be short of the money and you will be just need not a huge amount of them to finish the project. To finalize everything. Are you ready to do this? If yes, you're a good producer. If no...
I love that. That's really good. And that shows how much you believe in your movie. You know?
Absolutely.
Yeah. Oh, that's great. Do you have any other advices or tools or tips that you can tell like our beginner filmmakers or people who are starting their careers?
Welcome to Kazan. I'm joking. No, see, I'm serious, but at the same time, really, no, I think the more important thing is you have to really know the filmmaking and you know the history, you know, so just don't think that you can start from the very and bring something new. You have to, you know, it's like all the contemporary art painters, for example. You have to, first of all, have the academic school of the classical painting, you know, so just, and after that you can develop it and to make it already, you know, more arts way of the sort in contemporary art or something like etc. But it must be growing from the very beginning. I mean, from the classical school, from the classical education, from the feeling of the what was happening in the cinema. All it's already more than 100 years. It's quite big history. You have to know this, you know.
I totally agree. You can't create something new without knowing the basics.
Basement. Yeah. Must be placement, and it's like a cultural code, you know, which you have to reach. Doesn't no other way, no. All the experience, like everything. One of the funny story, it's about the Quentin Tarantino. Everybody knows that he working in the when he rent the cassettes film rent in Los Angeles for many years. So mm-hmm. he watch everything, you know, practically. And after this, we have a Tarantino. I don't think it's so. It's occasional. It's really true. It's like this, you know. So just.
I also wanted to ask, what are you working on right now? Is there any project you're working right now, and everything is a little bit frozen?
No, it's not frozen. It's a bit slow, but still working. You know, unfortunately, already more than 7 years since I left the studio, I am concentrated not on the feature films, but concentrated the documentary and musical films which related to the classical music, especially. Mm-hmm. We are, for example, released in 2011, very famous films, musical Odyssey in St. Petersburg, it's very famous film all around the world. It was screening everywhere in the States, in Japan, in all the other countries, in Europe, etc., etc. It's a musical film where the two actors, two main hero, Dmitry Hvorostovsky, unfortunately he is already not with us for more than 2 years, and Renee, Fleming, the gold standard of soprano, who is performing in the United States, it's opera diva, mm-hmm. and both of them, Renee was still amazing person, and Dima is the greatest artist, etc., etc. And now we are working on another project, which I hope will be finished till the end of the year. And the title of the film is Rock Baritone. It's about another opera star. It's already pure documentary, but a lot of the music as well. It's, his name is Evgeniya Nikitin. He is the number one. Or one of the top, I cannot say number one, it's not racing, it's not a sport, it's classical music, it's opera, but still he is one of the top Wagner's baritone all around the world, and he's Russian at the same time, and was one very stupid, and at the same time he's like rock music, but already just for himself, because he is playing and they write the music and the songs and performing it sometimes in the club in St. Petersburg when he's not so busy with his main career, and the main career is the opera singer. And how is it combined in one person? It's very unusual situation.
Evgeniya Nikitin is a universal singer. His ability to sing both more lyrical or more heroic, more dramatic roles is unique.
Tout le monde m'a dit non, mais il est là. Je croyais que c'était un machiniste.
How it was happened that the person like this from the very north of Russia, from Murmansk, become one of the top Wagner singers, opera classical singers all around the world. And the title of the film, Rock Baritone.
Yeah. I saw the trailer, so I'm very excited to see the film when it comes out. Yeah, it looks great. Stanislav, thank you so much for joining. Thank you so much for sharing your experience. Your career sounds incredible. And we're looking forward for more conversations and advices from you. We will be in the future.
Thank you for inviting the career. It's very simple. And please welcome to Anglitel Cinema launch in St. Petersburg. If you sometimes have a chance to visit St. Petersburg, I understand that it's very difficult to compete with Hermitage, with Russian Museum, with all our suburbs, with the palaces, and with the very old and amazing and beautiful city. But still, if you have a chance, always very welcome.
Thank you. I hope our audience also will get a chance when COVID is over and we all start traveling again, hopefully. Yeah.
Sure.
Yeah, thank you so much. Looking forward to see you again. Bye.